Welcome, and thank you for taking time to listen to another sermon from First Christian Church here in Flora. We're on week 3 of our series on the book of Matthew, Kingdom Come, as we look at this theme of God's kingdom coming to this earth through the life of Jesus, who showed us the way. And we've seen through his history of his family and his story of where he's come from and where he's going, how he was the answer to all the promises from the prophets. And as we've looked at this, we begin to see how now, through his testing last week, now he begins to give us this great sermon, this launching point to show us the way and what to do. We'll begin it this week at the Sermon on the Mount, and Trey will finish it next week for us. But while it's stretched over a few chapters here, it's still a powerful portion of Scripture. It touches on a lot of timely and specific issues, sensitive topics like anger and lust and divorce, getting even on giving and tithing, on worry and judging, and on good deeds. Jesus was faced with a lot of superficial religious people around him. The religious leaders of the time were often about their own authority, their own power, their own ways, their own standing in society. And so they used religion as a way to feel like they leveled up. But Jesus came in to kind of cut them back down, to say, we got to look at the source of what is the strength. It's not in the title, it's not in the position, but it's at the heart of what things are truly matter. And so Jesus uses this speech, this sermon here, to address, he faces it all head on, to challenge them in their thinking. It was a call to wake up, to get real, to let's go back to the basics. It was the call to challenge their spiritual shallowness. And it's the same call for us today. It's not only a challenge, but it's a call for us to walk in obedience. To be obedient and to trust are difficult things. To trust and obey are very difficult things. They challenge us at our core. In 1999, John F. Kennedy Jr. flew his small airplane from New York City to his family home in Massachusetts for a wedding. On boarding were his wife Carolyn and her sister. Though Kennedy was a licensed pilot, he had not yet been approved for instrument flight, using only instruments to navigate. While their takeoff was delayed until after dark, Kennedy should have waited for daylight or sought out more experienced pilot to help. Yet Kennedy took off into the darkness. Their plane never reached its destination, and all three passengers were killed in the crash. Investigators determined that the crash was likely caused by disorientation from flying over open water at night without any landmarks or visible horizon. Kennedy's lack of experience may have led him to trust what he thought was seeing more than what the instrument panel was telling him. All of us face temptation to walk according to our sight instead of faith. Faith in God will keep us from crashing. Human reason will fail us at times, but God never fails. His word keeps us on the right course as long as we choose to obey. So in the opening of the book of Matthew, we saw this preparation for the kings and the study of the genealogy and the preparation for Jesus' ministry in the next section of Matthew's writing. But we find now this preparedness for the king. Before, it was all about, well, how did he come? But now it's time for him to take the throne. It's time for his ministry. And so Matthew is intended to blend throughout the book, throughout his writing, these words of Jesus' deeds, but also Jesus' teaching. He's using both of these hand in hand to connect with the audience, to connect with us as we read and we share in this. And so what we see is this: what Jesus was indeed the Messiah. He came to fulfill all the ways of the Old Testament law and the prophets. The Sermon on the Mount is viewed as many different ways and perspectives, but ultimately it is a gift of ethics and grace. It's an introduction of God's kingdom in our lives. And so as we hear this sermon, it should not be taken as new law, but rather a description of the character of the produced by God. And it should live in the lives of the followers and believers. So it's not saying this is something new, but rather, hey, it's caused us to stir and to cause us to reconnect. This is about the character of the kingdom that the gospel creates. When we choose to walk in the ways of the Lord, this is the life that we choose to embrace, we choose to receive. It's a walk of obedience. It's a walk that is desired of all believers. This is important because the demands of the sermon could seem like they're almost impossible to fully keep because we're in a broken state, we're a broken humanity. But yet, there is still a level of obedience that real followers of Jesus should strive for. Just because we know that we're sinful doesn't mean we stop trying. We keep moving forward. And so the way that we view this text is from the perspective already has been there, but yet we're not there yet. In other words, God's saving work produces real righteousness expressed in the sermon, but there's a longing for the day when the sermon will be fully realized here on earth. We see this in Matthew chapter 6, verse 10. And as he teaches us how to pray, he says, "Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven, the kingdom that is yet to come." So what we learn is how to live for the kingdom. Jesus' teaching is bold, but our human side, we want to say, "Hold up, wait, tell me all the details, lay it all out there for me." But Jesus doesn't spend a lot of time working out all the potential issues of the conflict. He could go down every rabbit hole, he could lead us astray, but he just gives us the facts. But the problem is so often, we get in the way. We don't make it possible for all these things to take root. There's a story about a man who was seeking enlightenment, and so he traveled afar, and he went before a guru and asked him, "Master, what do I have to do to be enlightened?" And the guru said, "Meditate for 1 hour a day for 10 years, and you will be enlightened." Well, the man said, "Well, my brother meditates for 1.5 hours every day. I want to be better than him, so I will meditate for 2 hours a day. How long till I am enlightened?" And the master said, 20 years. And the man said, wait. I'm working twice as hard. Shouldn't I see twice the results?" And the master said, "Twice the ego, half the results." We are willing to give up our things. Are we willing to give up our ego to be praised for it? Are we willing to give up the space that is needed for what really matters? In other words, so often what Jesus is telling us here is ready for us to receive. But what we're trying to do is we're trying to fill so much else in there of all the details, of all the facts, rather than just trust and obey him. So Jesus highlights the truth for us without fully dealing with all the potential conflicts, with all the extra expectations. It's black and white. He doesn't deal with all the gray that's between us. But what we see, as he later says in Matthew 5, it says, "In the same way, let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven." He says, essentially, this is what it means to be obedient, to be a light to the world. We worry about all this other stuff, but he says, have you made yourself available to be a light to the world? What he's doing, he's trying to break through our heart and shell. He knows that we put all this guard up and we try to defend ourselves. And he says, that's the problem. Just like the early religious leaders, they had this superficial religion. That it was all about the title. It was the status quo. It was to be seen, but not to be lived out. And so what he does here, he uses this teaching and this boldness to be provocative. It's shocking. It's conflicting with what we think and what we've thought. But yet, he says, this is how we live. And so therefore, as he writes this out for us, as Matthew shares this, we see that he says, "Blessed are those who mourn, for they are comforted." He says, "Those who are sad, they will receive comfort." Matthew 5:11 says, Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Persecution should make you rejoice. Then verse 20 says, "For I tell you that unless your righteousness surpasses that of the Pharisees and your teachers of the law, you will certainly not enter the kingdom of heaven." He says, keeping rules does not make you religious. Just to check the check marks doesn't make you religious. And so the Sermon on the Mount is a problem for people who claim to be religious, and yet it's going to attack the status quo. It's going to attack the things that we just go through because it's our tradition, rituals, things that have hurt the church for years, because that's what we always do. Jesus was direct in showing, and even provocative words are not only appropriate, but yet here they are. They're helpful. The struggle about the rules is, And I'm in this boat all the time. Not everyone chooses to follow them. And when they're reminded of them, we always assume that they're for someone else. Right? It's always that person when you say, "Hey, we need everyone to do this," because you're trying not to offend anybody or hurt anybody. It's always the people who are already following the rules feel like they've broken the rules. But those who have broken the rules never feel like they've done anything wrong. They're always looking around, oh, they must be talking about them or over there. But that's the problem. We like a good rule because it makes everyone else behave. Jesus' teaching was shocking, authoritative, and different. It pierced the veil of superficial religion. It was breaking it down. It was designed to call people radically to a God-centered change. And so when we receive shocking information, it's also motivating. There are things that motivate us once we see the harsh reality of it. I'll be honest. When it comes to this, I immediately walk in and I apologize to them. I'm the worst. I am literally the worst. I have a horrible gag reflex. I can't handle the teeth cleaning process when I go in there. So they always have to walk lightly, and x-rays are horrible. And so when I walk in, I know that I'm a pain to their day. And so I immediately apologize. But we all sit there in that time alone in a room, and you know that dreaded question is coming to ask. How often do you floss? And it doesn't matter how often you do it, it's never enough. But as you sit there in the room and you see all the pictures of gum disease on the wall, you think to yourself, ugh. And so while they come in and say, well, you probably should do a little bit more, they're not lecturing us, but we know that's exactly what's taking place. But as we see the imagery on the walls, it's enough to change our perspective, at least for a couple weeks. And that's the purpose of the Sermon on the Mount. It's showing us the ethics of grace in this shocking and startling manner so it would change our ways. As we see in Matthew chapter 5, it shows us the Beatitudes here. And it says, now when Jesus saw the crowds, he went up on the mountainside and sat down. His disciples came to him, and he began to teach them. He said, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for those will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven. For in the same way, the persecuted prophets who were before you. What we see here is the Beatitudes are a series of statements that connect the concept of blessing. So as you look at these verses, as we just read them aloud, you would see this word blessed throughout. And it connects the entire passage of blessing. Blessed is to receive God's approval, his favor, his endorsement, or even congratulations. Many people make the mistake of connecting blessed with being happy. It is true that blessings are happiness. It does make us happy. But it's not the deep enough sense that happiness can often mean something shallow or insignificant. Something can make you happy and then we can be angry moments later. And so when we see this, it's showing us that the blessings of Matthew 5 is connected to receiving God's grace. We cannot separate the two. And so God initiates blessing by graciously trying to save people. We respond to God's gift by blessing God with praise and obedient living. Experiencing God's reign just motivates us to live the right way, to live right into the future. Therefore, blessing is a reality, not just something in the future. It's a unique way of living in the light of something that is going to be much bigger than ourselves in the future. And so as we all have different seasons and rhythms of life, we look forward to different things with anticipation and excitement. We're always saying, I can't wait till that next trip, until that next holiday, till we're all back together again, to the next season of life, the promotion, whatever it is. We all go through seasons and we often miss out on what's happening right now. But when we look back, it's hard not to see how we were made through each stage with each season because of God's blessing. It's the beautiful emotion of love that we share. In the beginning, you were single, and then you began dating, and you were filled with great joy. Your relationship began to blossom. It continued to grow. You begin to share together. You become engaged, and then there's a great anticipation of getting married. Then you're married, and you have this newfound joy of togetherness, but then you have family and kids and grandkids and new seasons and new times. All this is a blessing of God. And when we look back at our lives, we can see that all that was entirely dependent on Christ. And so when we see this Sermon on the Mount, many just try to make it a law that we carry with us. There's just a new set of rules to obey. But rather, the Sermon on the Mount is as Jesus was saying, because you are what you are, and because of the future of what it is, of what we have to come, of this kingdom of heaven, this is how you should live. Because of my blessing, because of the future, this is where I need you to be. It is the ethics of grace. It's the Beatitudes are an expression of blessing. But what was Jesus trying to say through these blessings? What was he laying out there for us? Well, what he see here is this. To read verse 3 through 6 again, it says, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. The verses are direct toward how blessed people, those who have received God's blessing, God's approval, relate to God. The first few Beatitudes capture what faith looks like. Those who have completely dependent to being poor in spirit, authentic spirituality begins here with a deep understanding of how much God loves us. I think that is one of the hardest things to kind of get through. We assume that there's love, that we experience love, but do we understand of how much he loves us? I think like that's one of the greatest rewards that you see, especially as a parent, to watch your little ones as they embrace you and they hug you and they cling to you. You feel that expression of love and the depth that's needed there. And so as we see here, it's showing how much we need the love of God. To be poor is the context of not just below the poverty line, but it's ideal of the spiritual bankruptcy. It is to acknowledge that absolute inadequacy, without God, without Jesus, we are nothing. We have total dependence on him. And this is the opposite of what the pride of the Pharisees were experiencing and expressed. But we have to have the heart of Isaiah 66. It says, has not my hand made all these things? And so they came into being, declares the Lord. They are the ones I look on with favor, those who are humble and contrite in spirit, and who tremble at my word. It's this poor in spirit that possess the kingdom of heaven. Those who are fully dependent also take sin seriously. They mourn, as verse 4 says. Once again, the way Jesus is bold here, it leaves a lot of questions. The use of the word mourning in the Bible, as we see in several passages, describes mourning over sin, that sin should make us sick. And so often we sin and it's no big deal. But sin should cause us to mourn. Psalm 119 says, streams of tears flow from my eyes, for the law is not obeyed. Jesus usually indicates that Jesus is calling his people to a view of life that shuns the lighthearted attitude regarding the serious issues of life. He says, we can't be so lighthearted when it comes to the nature of our sin. We can't just say, well, it's no big deal. I'll change it later. He says, as we read, we're able to drive comfort given to those who genuinely take sin seriously. Man, I messed up. There's comfort in genuine repentance. We see there's power when we are under control to be meek, as verse 5 says. Jesus is commanding the humble, those who refuse their own rights. Meekness is not a sign of weakness. It's a deeper understanding of greater power, that I am being authoritative to who is in control. I'm submitting to who is in power. The great power and dependency is upon God. It's a choice that even though you can assert yourself and you choose not to, meanness is only possible because it's the face of God, that he owns it all, that he is in control of it all. And that this is why the meek will inherit the earth. It says that the blessed must also keep up their right desires as they hunger and thirst for righteousness. Jesus uses these words, hunger and thirst, because it gives us a sense of desires. It's intense desires. When we have a craving, when I'm so hungry, I need to eat now. It reaches that we can relate to this. He is driving on this point. The kingdom-minded people do not just do good things once in a while. They have a passion and desire for righteousness. The longing of our hearts of a person who received by grace, when they receive God's grace, it fills us, satisfies us. It keeps those who famined for righteousness, that they will be satisfied. And so those all show us how, as true followers, it just we relate to God. It shows that the ethics of grace begin by considering carefully our response to the invasion of God's grace in our lives. That He's given it to us, but it's for us to receive. And so, as we come to a time in our services, we prepare to receive, to partake, and to share in communion, we are faced with these questions that the Sermon on the Mount begins to challenge us with. Remember, Jesus spoke boldly to challenge the status quo, to challenge what is just going on, the rituals and the traditions. So, the superficial faith describe us. Are we true followers of Jesus? Do you really know what it means to have a heart that has turned from sin and trust in Christ? The risk that we're all on is that shallowness will take over our walk with Christ. Has grace just become too normal? Has the beauty of the gospel faded for us? Will we have taken sin seriously? Does sin still bother us? Are we controlled by the Spirit? Are we seeking to please God or please man? Are we spiritually hungry? Do we long for righteousness? Do we want more of Jesus? And so Jesus preached this message for a reason. And how we needed to hear it again. We needed a shocking message to wake up the reality of what is happening. And it shows us what happens when God's grace invades our heart. How we are called to live. And so whether you make a choice intentionally in our minds, or whether you're making a desire of our heart, or we're taking an action of what we need to do, that God made a way and it invades us. His grace takes over us for those who have true, deep faith in the boldness in which we continue to live and to walk faithfully with Him. Yes, I will lift you high.